Rings.
Good morning, everybody. How are you all doing today? Well, today I'm continuing a series we've been doing over the past couple of weeks on attitude. Now, when they told me that I was going to be doing the series, I was very excited. I have two young daughters, so I was like, I need to learn everything I can about attitude. But as it turns out, that's not exactly what we're talking about. That's not the kind of attitude we're referring to. what we're talking about when we say attitude is the way that you choose to respond to the things that happen in life, the person that you choose to allow yourself to become when we experience life's ups and downs. Okay, in life, there's all kinds of things that we can't control. A lot of the times we wish we could. We wish we could control maybe the way people treat us, that we could make things fair. We wish we could change the things that have happened in our past. A lot of us want to be able to control what happens in our future, right? We want a 5-year plan. We want to know what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. But life isn't always that simple, right? I mean, you could wake up tomorrow and something could happen that would change your plan permanently, for better or for worse, right? And so a lot of life, though we don't like to think about it sometimes, is outside of our control. Oftentimes we're reactionary, we're doing the best we can with the hand that we've been dealt. But there is one thing that no matter what, you are always in control of. There's one thing that's always our decision, and that is our attitude. Okay, time and time again throughout history, people have proven that an attitude can conquer anything. You can overcome anything. We've seen people who've gone through some of the worst troubles that we can imagine. You know, they've dealt with starvation, they've dealt with suffering, they've dealt with neglect. There's been grief and loss, and people have come out on the other side of that bigger, better, stronger as a result of what they chose, the attitude they chose to have. Okay, and so our attitudes are very, very important tools for us. Okay, and so today I want to talk about one of these attitudes that we can develop. I want to talk about what we've kind of dubbed an attitude of see-through. An attitude of see-through. And what I want to talk about today is the idea of being able to see through the day-to-day. Okay, I want to talk about being able to see through what's just before you and I, like our average conversations, to realize, to be able to recognize that everything we do, every person we interact with, every experience that we have is touched in some way by the divine. Hey, I want to talk about being able to see God at work in the world around us and being able to recognize the voice and leading of the Holy Spirit as we live our lives. And so today I want to start with a Bible verse. I want to start by showing you an example of a person who did exactly that, who saw something that by all intents and purposes he probably shouldn't have been able to recognize, he shouldn't have been able to see. And I want to talk about Acts 13:4-12, and this is a story about the Apostle Paul and Barnabas, and we have a little bit of context here that we start with, so if you'll just follow along with me, it says, "So Barnabas and Saul were sent out by the Holy Spirit. They went down to the seaport of Seleucia, and they sailed to the island of Cyprus. There, in the town of Salamis, they went to the Jewish synagogues and preached the word of God. John Mark went with them as their assistant." Okay, so afterward, they traveled from town to town across the entire island until finally they reached Paphos, where they met a Jewish sorcerer and a false prophet named Bar-Jesus. Now, we will later learn that this is kind of a pseudonym he was going by. Bar-Jesus meant son of Jesus. And so this is this false prophet, and he seems to maybe already know about the Christian church. He's kind of trying to use that momentum or presenting himself as someone who's a believer. And that's possible, or maybe it's just a really weird coincidence, but his name is Bar, or his pseudonym that he goes by is Bar-Jesus. And he detached himself to the governor, Sergius Paulus, who was an intelligent man. The governor invited Barnabas and Saul to visit with him, for he wanted to hear the word of God. But Elymas, which is what the sorcerer's actual name was, Elymas the sorcerer, as his name means in Greek, interfered and urged the governor to pay no attention to what Barnabas and Saul said. He was trying to keep the governor from believing. All right, so if we could just go to the next slide, that would be... Oh no! It's supposed to flip, and there's like another another piece. There we go. All right, so yeah, Saul, also known as Paul, was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he looked the sorcerer in the eye. Then he said, "You son of the devil, full of every sort of deceit and fraud, you enemy to all that is good, will you never stop perverting the true ways of the Lord? Watch now, for the Lord has laid his hand of punishment upon you, and you'll be struck blind. You will not see the sunlight for some time. Instantly, mist and darkness came over the man's face and eyes, and he began groping around, begging for someone to take him by the hand and lead him. When the governor saw what happened, he became a believer, for he was astonished about the teaching of the Lord. Okay, so we have this story about this man called Elymas, who's this sorcerer, and he's tricked all the people around him, okay? He's tricked his way up the rungs of power. He's tricked all the people associated with Sergius Paulus, and he's tricked Sergius Paulus himself, okay? Which is not an easy feat. The Bible actually calls him an intelligent man, okay? This isn't just some poor guy who got tricked. This is someone who we would probably look up to, okay? He's established. He's a hard worker. His men seem to love him and care for him. And so this is someone who we would probably respect. And he's someone who's intelligent, and he's been tricked by this hoodlum, this sorcerer, this trickster. And so pretty much kind of like Grimma Wormtongue that we showed at the beginning here, except he probably had eyebrows. So that's what we've got going on here. And Paul and Barnabas walk into this situation, okay, and they don't know Elymas. They don't know him. They haven't been around him. You know, they haven't had time to figure out what his tricks are and how he is doing this. But in a situation where everybody else has been tricked, they're able to see through it right away. Paul is able to see right through his disguise, and he's able to act boldly as a result of that. And the Bible tells us why Paul was able to see what no one else was able to see. And Paul was able to see this because he was filled with the Holy Spirit, right? It wasn't because Paul was smarter than Sergius Paulus. It wasn't because Paul was saved and the other guy wasn't. It wasn't because he paid really close attention to the sermons on Sunday, although I hear that is the root of all wisdom. You should probably try that. No, it was because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul lived his life in such a way that he was able to hear and discern the will of God and notice it when God was speaking to him. Now, when we start talking about living a life like this, when we start talking about developing an attitude that hears the will of God, that listens to the Holy Spirit, and is in relationship with the Holy Spirit so that we can respond to Him, it becomes kind of an uncomfortable situation for some of us. This is something that we have a tendency to kind of step back from in the church. I mean, we're a little bit more comfortable with rules. Now, as much as we like to say we're not, you know, as much as we like to say, I don't like rules, I'm not legalistic. Rules, I think they become popular in the church sometimes because it's sort of a comfort zone for believers. So like if I was standing up here today and I said, look, if you want to know the will of the Holy Spirit, what you have to do is just remember these three special questions that you have to ask anytime. And if you're worried about what you need to do, ask these three questions and that will help you determine the will of the Holy Spirit. We'd be right on board, wouldn't we? Right? Like, well, that's the language we understand. We're used to that kind of stuff. But it's not that simple. When we're talking about the Holy Spirit, we're talking about a relationship, right? We're talking about real relationship with an unpredictable God who does what he wants and doesn't really care what people have to say about it. You know, we're talking about a relationship. It's messy. It's confusing. It can be embarrassing sometimes. And so this becomes something that we're a little bit uncomfortable with. And we have a tendency to just kind of step into wanting to teach wisdom, right? We want to just teach that part of faith where we're saying, oh, here are three rules that you can follow. Here's a catchphrase that you can remember or apply to every part of your life. And we become really comfortable with that. And what I want to say today, it's not that wisdom is bad. Wisdom is great. It's good for us to learn wisdom. I actually have some verses, I think, on the next slide that say that wisdom is something we should be seeking. Yeah, do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, they kind of personify wisdom in this verse. It says, love her and she will watch over you. The beginning of wisdom is this, get wisdom at all costs, though it costs all you have, and gain understanding. Wisdom is something we should be seeking. But what I'm here to say today is that it's not everything. It's not the entirety of our Christian journey. Wisdom without the leadership of God is a broken thing. Okay, and I want to give you an example of a person who had all the wisdom in the world, okay, and he, for him, wisdom still wasn't enough on its own. I want to talk about the person of Solomon. Okay, Solomon was the third king of Israel. And Solomon was the son of David, and Solomon is considered to be the wisest king who ever lived. Okay, and this wasn't just, you know, something he was born with. This was actually a supernatural gift from God. Okay, God appeared to Solomon one night and said, Solomon, like, ask me for anything, and I will give it to you. Now, we often say in church, like, you know, God's not a genie. Well, in this case, he kind of actually functioned that way for a moment with Solomon. He said, ask me for anything, and I will give you that. And Solomon, who was already a pretty smart guy, said he wanted the wisdom to lead Israel. And God was pleased with his request, and he granted him that wisdom. And this became legendary, fabled kind of wisdom. People would travel from all around the world, and they would come to hear Solomon talk, to ask him questions. And so Solomon, under his reign, Israel experienced some of the greatest years of its existence in some ways. I mean, they had economic prosperity, they had agreements. Sorry, I'm getting a bit of a cold. They had agreements with, like alliances with other nations. For the first time, by the world's viewpoint, Israel became a real superpower. Okay, but under Solomon's reign, something else happened, and that is that Israel kind of began to slip away from God. Israel began down this path to destruction where they sort of stopped following God. They started worshiping other gods. And this, I mean, Solomon is not the only person to lay the blame on about this. Every king of Israel made mistakes. But for example, his father David, he was the kind of person who, even when he made mistakes, came back to God. He always returned to him. He remained faithful until the day that he died. Okay, but Solomon sort of drifted away, slipped away, and stopped following God entirely, to the point that we actually see, I don't know if we can find the verse in Kings. Sorry. We're going to have to go back, I think. It was another one of those ones where it was like the same slide. So go back to where there was... Okay. Don't worry. Go back to where you were then. But yeah. I don't know if it's not up there or what I've done, but I've messed up somewhere on the slide. So that is what it is. But yeah, he began to worship other gods, and he didn't return to God. And as a result, God sort of decided to take the kingdom away from Solomon and give it to one of his subordinates. And this led down a dark path for Israel. Eventually, it led to their exile, and it led to the destruction of the nation of Israel. Okay, now, I've heard a lot. What I want to ask is why? I wonder why somebody who was given supernatural wisdom from God could still make the mistakes that lead to that kind of an end. And I've heard lots of people give guesses as to why that would happen. I've heard lots of suggestions. A lot of people like to talk about the fact that Solomon, he had a lot of wives. Solomon married several hundred women as his wives, and he had several thousand concubines. And these were women from other countries. These were women who worshipped other gods and could have led him astray. I mean, I consider myself to be a moderately smart guy, and I can't understand one woman. So it is possible that all of his wisdom was directed to trying to figure out what they wanted. I can't speak to that necessarily. But in my reading of Solomon's reign and of King David's reign, there's one thing that I can think of that really it points to me to be one of the reasons that Solomon slipped away from faith. And that is, there's this term that you can find in the Bible called where somebody inquires of the Lord. Okay, they inquire of the Lord. And this term means that a person seeks the Lord's advice, is answer for some issue that they have in their life. Like if they've got if there's a battle coming, if they're worried about something, if they need to lead their nation some direction, they will inquire of the Lord. And when they do this, we're not talking about kind of, I've lost my keys, God, help me find them. This is a big deal. This is the kind of thing where it's like, you're praying all night until you hear the voice of God. Right? They're on their face before God, you know, tears streaming down your face kind of thing. We're talking about seriously seeking an answer. Like we're praying until we hear yes, no, maybe, whatever, but we're praying until we know that we've heard from God. That's what we're talking about when we say that a person inquired of the Lord. Now, Solomon's father, King David, he ruled this way. Okay, when you read through the accounts of his reign, you will actually see that he inquires of the Lord a lot. I actually have a list of them. There's 9 times in the scriptures that I have it. There's 9 times in the scriptures that David inquires of the Lord. There they are. Okay, and you could say that in the Psalms and in other circumstances, there are lots of other times that you could find, maybe you could say that he did, but there are 9 clear times that David inquired of the Lord. This is how he ruled. Okay, he may not have been as smart as Solomon, may not have had the wisdom of Solomon, but he spent his days on his knees before God, asking for his leadership, seeking his voice. And when you talk about King Solomon, That term appears a little bit less. It actually, as far as I can tell, as far as me and Google together can find, there are zero times that Solomon inquires of the Lord. So what I think happened is that Solomon kind of felt that he had the wisdom. He felt like it was a done deal, right? He asked for the wisdom. God said yes. It was granted. There you go. He's got it. He doesn't have to seek God anymore. I think Solomon became so wise that he forgot to seek the wisdom giver. Okay, I think he became so wise that he forgot to seek the wisdom giver. And this is a danger that we can run into, okay? Because if we get uncomfortable with the idea of listening to the voice of God, if we get uncomfortable with the idea of living moment to moment with God, and we just kind of seek wisdom, we just kind of seek good ways to make good decisions, you know, that will work. Okay, we live in a society that, has, for the most part, and it's less and less like this every day, but we live in a society that follows Christian values in a sense. They've adopted a lot of Christian values, okay? If you talk about trying to be peaceful with people, if you talk about trying to forgive people, if you talk about, you know, being hardworking, being charitable, these are things that North American society still kind of values today. And they've adopted this because these things work, right? These are Christian values that don't just benefit you one day, you know, when I die and I go to heaven, you know, God will bless me for doing it. But when you do those things, you'll actually see the result in your life, right? You're going to become a more peaceful person. You're going to see the benefits in your life and the lives of people around you. It's good for us, it's good for society, and as a result, I've met a lot of people who've never stepped foot in a church, a lot of people who are secular people, and they live by Christian principles better than a lot of Christians that I know. Okay, that's not what makes us different. What makes us different, one thing that only a believer will have, one thing that only somebody who follows Christ will have, is the leading of the Holy Spirit, is real, genuine relationship with God. The ability to hear his voice in situations and to follow him, okay? So today I want to talk about how we can learn to do that. This is what Paul had, okay? Paul had relationship with God. Paul was able to hear his voice, to discern what he wanted. And what I want to talk about today is how we can learn to hear the Holy Spirit, how we can learn to hear his voice, and how we can learn to follow him. And what I want to do is I actually want to talk about three things that we can do. Now, I know I kind of hated on that idea a little bit earlier. I said, oh, we always have three rules. But this is a trick, okay? Because what we're doing is I'm talking about how we can have relationship with God, how we can hear his voice and follow him, and then I'm moving the rules back one step. These are rules that will help us to learn to do that. So everybody wins, okay? I still get to preach an actual sermon, and we're gonna learn about this. At the core of all of this is a relationship, okay? We want relationship with God, okay? Christianity is not about making good decisions. Okay, I'm going to say that again because a lot of you probably thought that it was, may have thought that, but Christianity is not about making good decisions. Christianity leads to good decisions. It's about relationship with God. Okay, Christianity leads to good decisions, but it's about relationship with God. And at the core of every relationship is communication, okay? And so this is what we're going to learn to work on. I remember when my wife and I were first married, we were living in Toronto, and we decided we were going to go to Canada's Wonderland. And we got off the bus, and we were on our way into Canada's Wonderland through where, like, that area where the gates are, and everybody kind of all converges. And I look over at my wife, and she looks over at me, and she says, "Bah!" And I kind of got startled, and I stepped back, and then I ran into a person who I wasn't looking at. They weren't looking at me. We just smashed into each other, okay? Our heads bounced off each other. We fell backwards. And so, you know, we kind of apologize, dust each other off, and we continue walking. And my wife glares at me, and she says, "Tyler, I warned you that you were going to run into him." And I said what any red-blooded man would say in that moment. I said, "No, you didn't. You said blah, 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 blah." And I always remember her response. At that moment, she said something. It was one of those moments where I was like, oh, now I began to understand what marriage was going to be. She looked at me and she said, "Tyler, we've been married for 3 months now. You need to get better at nonverbal communication." So, look, We've been married for 7 years. I can stand here today and tell you that I have not mastered nonverbal communication, okay? But I have, I think, gotten better, right? A little better? Yes, I'm getting thumbs up from the back. Okay, this is good. Yeah, the other night, Ayla was putting the girls to bed, and she was like, she went, and I was like, oh, you want me to get you a bottle of water, check to see if the doors are locked, and put down a mat for the dog? And she was like, yes, Tyler, but don't yell it next time, because you're going to be... Right? So we're getting there. It's baby steps. It's baby steps. And so we need to learn to practice communication. And what I'm going to talk about today is three things that we can do to practice communication with God. And the first is this. We need to practice the presence of God. Okay? We need to practice the presence of God. And this one, it simply boils down to time. Okay? You can't learn to communicate better with a person unless you spend time with them. All right? And so we need to give time for God to speak. We need to give time that we talk to God and take time with him, all right? And so if that's 15 minutes a day when you wake up, if that's sometime in your evening, if you can just set aside time for God, this is important because we can't learn to communicate with somebody unless we spend time with them. Now, I know it's hard to find time in your day for something like that. I know it's hard. I have kids. I have a job. I know that our lives can be pretty stressful, okay? But we are good at finding time for the things that we're passionate about. We're good at finding time for things that we really care about. I don't know if you've ever heard about this thing called NaNoWriMo. NaNoWriMo, it's National Novel Writers Month. It began with a couple friends sitting around deciding in November they were going to write a book, and then it's turned into this international sensation. Thousands of people around the world, they participate in it. And basically, in the month of November, you write a 50,000-word novel. Okay, and I don't know if you know about writing books, but that's like adding another full-time job to your life, okay? And when you look up kind of the stories of people who've done this, the testimonies of people who've gone through it, they aren't people, they don't quit their jobs, you know, they don't like go on vacation for a month, but they do this and they say, you know what, I always felt I didn't have time to write a book, I always felt I didn't have time to do that, but that month, you know, I got together with a friend and we just kind of decided we were going to work on it and we got through it, you know, we prioritized it for that month. We are good at prioritizing things. You will find time that you didn't know you had if you make something a priority in your life. Okay, so find a friend, somebody who will help hold you accountable, and make the decision to take time for it. But if you're the kind of person who's saying, no, Tyler, no, I can't. I can't. There's no way I'm going to be able to find 15 extra minutes. Then all right. Okay, look, what I want to start with, maybe what we need to do is we need to kind of build the passion to make time for God. And so what I want to start with is this suggestion. If you're like, hey, I've tried many times, but I can't seem to do it. If you just know that you can't find 15 minutes a day or some period of time to speak to God, then what I want you to do is I want you to look for every spare second that you can. Okay, I want you to start trying to think about prayer like it's an addiction. Like you're just looking for 1 second, one little moment that you can find to pray. Just look for one chance to talk to God. If you've got a couple seconds after doing the laundry, no one's expecting you back upstairs yet, just pray for a second. If you're sitting in a line, you know, and the line's going slowly, just close your eyes and pray. Look for every second that you possibly can. When you're driving, don't close your eyes, but pray. You know, take your opportunity to pray. And just look for every second that you can give. And don't be ashamed of the fact that you're only giving a couple seconds here and a couple seconds there. One of the worst things you can do with your faith, okay, is think that because you can't give enough, you shouldn't give anything. Give what you have. Look for the spare seconds in your day. Look for the spare moments that you have and start praying in those moments. And watch God take what little you've given and grow it, okay? Because look, I promise, when you spend time in the presence of God, it's addictive. When you spend time in the presence of God, you want more time in God's presence. And it will grow into a passion. Those few seconds that you give, those few moments, you will learn what it's like to actually be around God. You'll get to experience the healing of that disconnect that might make it so it's hard for you to find time to pray. And over time, you will become the kind of person who wants to actually take time, who can take time to pray throughout your day. And you're going to learn to hear his voice every moment of the day. Okay, and so that's one of the things we can do. We can learn to practice the presence of God. And the second thing we can do, if we can switch to the next one, is we need to learn to share what's in our hearts. Okay, we need to share what's really going on with us. Okay, how many of you have prayers sometimes where you're just kind of like, dear God, thank you for this day and the food, and God, please be with me today and watch over us. Amen. right? Like those are acquaintance prayers, right? Where you're just kind of going through the motions and you pray the same things that you always pray, right? We talk to acquaintances that way. You'll have a conversation with someone, you'll say, oh, hey, how's the weather today? You know, oh, how are you doing today? I'm doing great. Those kinds of discussions. But when you talk to your friends, usually you go a little bit deeper than that, right? Maybe you'll start that way, but usually you go a little bit deeper. You'll talk about the things that are really on your heart. You'll talk about the things that you really care about. And so when we pray to God, I want you to ask the questions like, what kind of things are you excited about? What kind of things scare you right now? What people are you thinking about? What people are on your heart that you really care for? What's important to you right now? And pray those things, right? Because God wants to hear those things. And as we pray about stuff that's actually happening in our lives, we include God in our lives. And when we come upon the circumstances, the things that we're worried about, the things that we're going to encounter during that day, you've already prayed to God about them. You've already talked to him about them. He's already a part of that in a special kind of way. And I've heard lots of people say things like, you know what, I think God already knows everything. Like, why would I bother telling him about what's going on in my life when God, he already knows all that he needs to know. Look, I work nights, okay, which means that I wake up in the middle of the day, and it's pretty much a coin toss who wakes me up. Sometimes my wife will come upstairs and wake me up. Other times, people will jump on my face, and little people will be like, Daddy, get up, right? This is 50-50 what happens. And on the days that my wife wakes me up, thank goodness, we will usually have a bit of a discussion as I get up and get ready, right? We'll talk about what happened while I was asleep. She'll say, oh, this is what me and the girls did. You know, they were really excited about this. This is how they felt. But when I go downstairs, probably the first thing I do is I ask my girls, hey, what did you do today? I already know the story, right? I already have the information. My wife told me. She told me all about it. I don't need to know that. But it's not what I'm going into that conversation for. I'm not asking them because I want information. I'm asking them because I want interaction, right? I'm asking them because I want to see them light up and tell me about their day. I want to see the excitement come from them. I want to hear it from them, right? I think a lot of times, God, you know, he asks us to pray not because he needs the information. Sometimes he asks us to pray because he wants us to kind of work things out and think things through. But I think most of the time, all of the time, God wants us to pray because he loves us and he wants to hear from us. Love has this crazy way of making it okay to hear the same story a second time, because you're not looking for information, you're looking for interaction. And so we should pray what's on our heart. We should tell God the kinds of things that are going on in our lives, what's worrying us and what's exciting us. We need to pray what's in our hearts. And the third thing we can do is we can learn to listen. Okay, we can learn to listen to the voice of God. All right, now if we're continuing the whole relationship theme, listening is not something that men are typically good at, but we can learn, remember, we can learn to listen. And listening to God can be a bit of a struggle for us because he doesn't speak in the way that, you know, we normally hear people speak. God rarely uses an audible voice. And so this is a challenge for us. We can struggle to learn to speak to God. And I think there are two big things that we're kind of afraid of when it comes to speaking with God. I think first, we're afraid that God's going to ask us to do something hard, right? I think we're afraid if we give him a chance to talk, he's going to ask us to do something crazy, okay? And I think that kind of depends on how you look at it. You know, I've heard on one side people say, I just don't want him to ask me to do something way too big for me or to really challenge my faith or anything like that. And I've heard other people say, you know, Christianity's boring. You know, those Christians, they live safe lives and whatever, but it's like, okay, what you might call him asking something hard, you could also call excitement, you could also call adventure. This is what turns our faith into something that's living and breathing. Giving God the opportunity to speak to us is what challenges us and grows us, okay, and this is something that's necessary for us. So we need to be bold enough to give him a chance to speak. Okay, we're really good at dumping words into a prayer, we're really good at saying all the things that we want to say, and then we say amen, and we kind of back off. Okay, but we need to, when you pray, when you take time with God, give him a moment to speak as well. Okay, if you got to close your eyes, close your eyes. If you have to raise your hands, raise your hands. Don't do that if you're driving. Okay, but close your eyes. Give God an opportunity to speak. Just listen. And it may be that he doesn't speak at all. And it may be that he speaks in an audible voice. Wouldn't that be crazy? Or it might be that, you know, you start to feel that he's giving you an impression in your heart. He's leading you towards something, that there's something that he really wants you to do. And you begin to discern, you begin to learn to hear the voice of God. And I think there's a second thing that we really fear when it comes to speaking to God. And I think that second thing is that we're going to do it wrong, that we're going to misinterpret, right? We all, somewhere deep down inside of us, we have this fear that, like, we're going to think we heard the Holy Spirit and it was actually the pizza we had last night. And then we're going to start a cult by accident, right? Like, That's kind of the fear that we have sometimes. Listen, I want to put your mind at ease a little bit. If you were the kind of person who's worried about starting a cult, you probably won't end up doing it. Okay, I think most people who did that, they kind of intended on it. And God's not trying to trick you. Okay, he is trying to speak to you clearly so you will understand him. It does take us a bit of practice and a bit of work. But you also should know that you don't have to do this on your own. Okay, there are lots of ways, if you feel the Holy Spirit is telling you, there are lots of ways that you can test that you can check it. Okay, one is that you can check against Scripture. Okay, God will never tell you anything through the Holy Spirit that goes against his Word, that goes against Scripture. So read your Bible, walk in the Word, and test everything that you hear against that. Okay, you can even use Google. Okay, so type in like verses about blank, right? And if you feel like God's talking to you about something specific, look up those verses. Now look at them in context, read the whole story that surrounds it, and don't just look up like people's opinions, look up actual Bible verses. But what God's Word says about a subject is the final word. Okay, and so we can always look at the Bible. And the second thing that we can do is we can talk to other people in the church. Okay, one of the reasons we have a body of believers is so that we can help one another to understand the will of God for our lives. Okay, and so you can talk to other people. If you feel that the Holy Spirit is telling you something, ask about it. All right, now I really do recommend that you look for somebody who at least you really respect as a believer. You know, somebody who you know has a good relationship with God, who reads their Bible, you know, who you know can lead you in the right direction, who will actually have good information for you. In particular, the best option would be to look for somebody with some kind of a credential. Okay, like Pastor Scott and Pastor Dave are people who've done this all their life, right? They help people with this exact issue. And so they're the right kind of people to go to. Sometimes we get nervous. We don't want to be like judged if we were wrong or if we were kind of off base or whatever. And we're afraid to talk to somebody who might know what they're talking about. But don't just tell your friend, because they'll be on board with whatever you say, and then you'll have your first follower for your cult. So don't do that. Look for somebody who knows what they're talking about, okay? But it's not rocket science, right? Look, if we're worried about getting it wrong, read the manual or ask an expert, right? Like that, it's not really something that we should be worried about. It takes practice, yes, but we can learn to understand what the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. All right, so those are the three things that we need to learn to do, okay? We need to learn to seek God's presence passionately. We need to learn to pray the things that are really on our hearts. And we need to learn to listen to the voice of God. Give him time to speak and boldly respond. Guys, wisdom alone is not enough. We need wisdom with the leading of the Holy Spirit. Okay, because Christianity is not about making good decisions. It leads to good decisions. It's about relationship with God. Christianity is about relationship with God. And the heart of every relationship is communication. So we need to learn to hear his voice. We need to learn to discern what it is that he's asking for us so that we can become the kind of people who inquire of God. We can become the kind of people who aren't just wise, but who actually seek the wisdom giver. Will you pray with me today? Dear Lord, thank you for your presence with us. Thank you, God, that you are a God who we can have real relationship with. Lord God, thank you for the fact that you speak to us. Lord, that there is no life, that there is no person who you are not active within. Lord God, we just pray that we would learn to hear your voice. God, we pray that we would learn to follow it. And God, that you would just be with us throughout every moment of practice, every stumble and fall. And Lord, that we would just grow in faith. And we would grow in you every day of our faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Does anybody have any questions before we go on? Before we move on? Yeah, Jared?
I was just thinking that when you were talking about starting time with God, this thing that's called our daily bread that comes in the mail or it might be email. There was one time I had some anger issues dealing with some situation that happened at CR, my celibate recovery group. And what the Lord was sort of showing me is like some verses in Ephesians about anger. And I kind of really felt like God had given me the words to say, Jeremy, don't be angry about this situation. It's just a test of trial to see where I can place you to do the music. But I always find that when you read those passages, then it sort of helps you to know that God's on your side anyway. So it's good.
Yeah, absolutely. Devotions are a great thing.
How am I going to word this without sounding like a total lunatic?
No problem.
With the whole trusting part.
Yeah.
That sounds easier, but it gets harder. How do you not take anything in the wrong way?
How do you not take anything the wrong way? Well,
you know, when you were talking about him not listening or something about not getting an answer or something like that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the two things that I suggested were always test against Scripture. So, like, God's never going to tell you anything that goes against the Bible, that goes against His Word. And the second thing is, you know, look to somebody who, you know, maybe has experience in this area. Somebody like Pastor Scott's a good example. And be honest and talk about, like, what you think the Holy Spirit's saying to you. Maybe, you know, I one of the things I learned in Bible college was to maybe step back for a moment before you just, like, utter a word from the Holy Spirit. So, like, you can feel really strongly like you're supposed to, oh, I've got to say something right now, you know, like, or you're bursting at the seams when God is speaking to you. But sometimes a little bit of wisdom would be to kind of speak to someone first, say, hey, like, look, this is what I feel the Holy Spirit's saying. Do you think that's on point? Do you think that's right? And then go ahead and go for it. Because, I mean, like, it's true. This is something that happens, especially in churches in the South. You know, people will just kind of blurt stuff out, say things that are maybe inappropriate. I think there are a lot of destructive stories about people who've claimed that the Holy Spirit said something or told them to do something and it wasn't true. And a lot of times that's people just trying to use that to kind of cover up their own ambitions. And so, I mean, as long as that's not our intent, I think we'll have an easier time learning to hear the Holy Spirit and follow His word. But yeah, always feel free to ask people and test against the Bible. If that answers your question, I hope.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have found in the last little bit, especially the Women's Bible Study just finished doing one called The Sacred Echo, which was on prayer.
Cool.
And when God really wants to speak to you, He'll speak in a variety of different ways. But like you just said, you know, to blurt it out right away, if you're not sure, it's interesting that as you walk through the next couple of days, you'll find that same message comes in a variety of ways to you.
Right,
and I specifically found that this year where I really felt that God had given me a verse. Then within a week later, it was again on a piece of letterhead that I never thought about. And then again, a week later, it jumped out again.
Cool.
And it's very interesting that God wants to give you a message. And if you're scared of whether you've heard it or not, He will repeat it again in different ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, I mean, I'm just thinking, Paul acted immediately, right? Like, he acted in the moment, but Paul was very well practiced at this. You know, he'd been living that kind of life, and he really knew when the voice of God was speaking. And so he acted boldly in the moment, and sometimes that is, you know, required. But yeah, Paul was well practiced. He was experienced. He was a professional. So yeah, if you're not sure, if there's an ounce of uncertainty, yeah, take your time, talk to people, and see if there's consistency in that message. Yeah, for sure. Really good. Hey, Grace, hold on. We got Mike.
And for every story like Paul, there's lots of stories in the Bible of people who either said no or decided they were going to ignore God, and God chased them down and got His way anyway.
Yeah, sure.
So, you know, sometimes you're sitting there going, I'm not sure if this is God, and like she said, he'll convince you. He's good at that. If He really wants you to do something, He'll convince you. Your sort of your job is to just be aware of the fact that He might be talking to you.
Maybe one for Grace, and then we'll call it quits.
I just want to say thank you, Tammy, for what you said, because I found that's true in my life. And I think it's a learning process, like when you're little or when you're just new at trying to hear the Lord. You're just not sure, like you can't trust, is that really what He's saying, or is that really going to work for me? Mm-hmm. But, you know, you begin to see the same thing happening or the same words appearing, just like she said. And I wanted to say something kind of funny. When my dog was little, he was totally wild. He was like, I'm the boss here. You got to listen to me. You never saw such a wild puppy. But eventually he grew up and he realized that, hey, it's not so bad living here, you know?
Sure.
But was obeying the leash was like crazy. But eventually he learned, and now he's at the point where if he wants something, we're walking down the street, he'll see what he wants and he'll look at it, which is usually somebody to go pet him across the street. And then he'll turn around and look at me, and I know he's communicating. Can we go there? So it's just so beautiful to see the way he's learned to trust me, because it took a lot of patience to put up with him. Yeah. And nobody can believe how affectionate he is now, and the fact that he listens and he asks. So I guess it's kind of the same with us with God. We just got to start out. We might be wild. We might say no.
Yeah.
But trying to make that time, because Satan will discourage you from taking the time to even read a devotion for 5 minutes, you know? Okay, there you go.
Hi, guys. So we're going to go into the baskets now. We're going to pass baskets around. There are innies and outies. So the innies are the ones that you put stuff into, and the outies are the ones that you take stuff out of. The outies will come around first. And yeah, those are just, if you're new here, don't feel obligated to give. Don't feel obligated to give anything. This service was our gift to you, but if you're somebody who calls this place home, then yeah, please feel free to give. And we're going to do a quote show as that happens. And I don't know where the hat is, so we'll have to deal with that later. All right. Thank you, guys. Bye.